Welcome out to service, everybody. Welcome if you're watching on the live stream. We're going to worship our mighty God. There's a rock that we can lean on. Let's all stand tonight and sing this out.
There's no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name is worthy of all our praise. Rock of salvation that cannot be moved.
Oh,
want him to increase in our life so that we'd be holy.
Oh.
wonderful Savior. Thank you, my God. I want to open our service in prayer tonight. I want to invite God to have his way to stir our heart. I want to invite God to meet with us at the altar tonight. Evangelist Gibson in the Philippines, I want to pray for him. Marriage seminar down in Sydney on the weekend. I want to pray, we're in India next week. I want to pray for that. Hornsby Revival coming up with Pastor Ron Chisholm. I want to pray for that. There's things right now that you need to pray about. I don't even know what your story is, but you know what your story is, and he knows what your story is, but he wants to hear your faith. He wants to hear your voice tonight. Let's take time and do that. Let's invite God just to minister. Let's thank him. Let's speak in faith tonight. Father, we just thank you for your presence, Lord God. We thank you, God. We have hope and we have life in you, Lord God. We just thank you. You're moving in our family. God, we thank you, God, that you're moving in these circumstances, these future events that I've spoken, Lord God. God, thank you that you're here among us tonight. I glorify you, Jesus. You're having your way in our life, Lord God. There's nothing that's too difficult for you, Lord God, in our life, Lord God. God, we recognize our need, God. We're thanking you, Lord God. God, we're praising you, Lord God. God, we just want to go to faith, Lord God. We're coming to the Lord just to preach your faith,
Father God, we do thank you for this opportunity to come before your throne. I pray your hand will be upon all the events coming up, God, that you would move powerfully in this state and in this city, my King. God, the outreaches we have planned before and after the conference, God, and the trip to India, God, I pray your anointing will be upon us as a church. Help us, God, in this busy season to be effective for your kingdom, God, and to see fruit that would remain brought into this church, God. Lives change. We lift up this service to you tonight, God. I pray that you would meet us in this place, God. Anoint Pastor Staples, give him the words to speak to our lives, that we would meet you at the altar, God, and leave here changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Great to see you in church tonight. Take a moment to encourage someone as you find your seat. Great to see you. Praise God. Regular service times. 6:30 this evening, 7 p.m. Wednesday night, 10:30 Sunday morning, adult and kids Bible hour at 9:30, and the building's open 9 o'clock Sunday morning, and an hour before the evening and the Wednesday night services for prayer. Invite you to come along to any of those things. You're able to come. Praise God. We've got home groups, home Bible study on Friday night, and we put them down, as you've seen on the calendar, as an outreach, which means it's great opportunity to invite somebody to come out and get to meet the people of God, but get to hear the word of God through the Bible study and the fellowship, which will be a blessing this Friday night. Next Saturday down in Parramatta, 8 a.m. Saturday morning, so require a bit of an early start for any of the men that are keen to go down. Pastor Roman Gutierrez is doing a men's discipleship meeting down in our Parramatta church, and I want to encourage you, if you're able to go down and be part of that, it will bless your life. He has just a tremendously stirring testimony, as many of us know, but a tremendously stirring ministry that really can help people turn a corner in their walk with God. Praise God. We've got a just a quick video. Pastor Scott McLean from Poland has put this video together of the recent impact team. We're going to run with that just before we take our offering. Praise God. Praise God. Pastor Scott said, please give a special thanks to Mick for the drone footage. And praise God. Having an impact in Europe, having an impact by the will of God, the plan of God here in Newcastle. I want to take an offering this morning for the work of God, both here and in Poland. Appreciate your giving. Appreciate your faithfulness. The Bible says that we will be given what's given to us, pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. God's a faithful God. Appreciate your giving this morning. Ben's going to pray for us as we take this offering.
Lord God, we thank you for all we're able to do in your kingdom, Lord God. That includes giving. And as we give with open hearts this morning, Lord God, cheerfully, pray that you bless every gift and give in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you. want to look together at the Word of God this morning. And we're going to look at the book of Colossians in chapter 3, the book of Colossians in chapter 3. And I'm just going to read one verse out there in a moment. And I read a story about a criminal that broke into a store, and rather than steal anything, he merely rearranged the price tags. And then the next day, the crafty criminal came back and purchased the most expensive clothes at a much cheaper price. And the cheaper was sold as expensive, and the expensive was sold as cheap. And we live in a world that has sometimes the price tags the wrong way around. We value things and put a high price or value on some things that shouldn't be that valuable. And the other way around, we devalue things that should be valuable. And I want to look at something this morning, something very simple. And I look at something that God values. And Colossians 3:12 is our text this morning. And I want to look at the value of humility. The value of humility. And I want to say, first of all, that I believe that humility is something that is valuable and important. It has something that's been devalued in our world. And I want to look at this with you this morning and encourage you with what the Word of God says and encourage you with how God wants us to be. Colossians 3:12, the Bible says this: "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness," we looked at kindness last week, "humility, gentleness, and patience." Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. We're going to hone in, we're going to focus on humility this morning from the Word of God. And I want to look firstly at the value of humility. And in our text and in many places in the Word of God, God names the things that that He values. God lets us know very clearly what He thinks is important and what He thinks is valuable, in the hope that we would think it's important and that we would value these same things. They would be the targets that we aim for with our life. We looked at, as I said last week, Proverbs 19:22, "What is desirable in a man is his kindness." And again, I think that's something that's been devalued in our world today, the idea of kindness. Galatians 5:22-23, it tells us about the fruit of God's Spirit alive in our heart, in our life. And it says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are things that God values highly, to the point that He puts His Spirit in our life that would produce this sort of fruit in our life. Yes. Self-control, gentleness, my goodness. Is that something that's important to you? Is that something that's important in your workplace? Is it something that's important in our society today? And so let me say this: without humility, we simply value things wrongly. Without humility, we easily value things wrongly. Webster's Dictionary says that humility is freedom from pride or arrogance. And we know that pride blinds us, and humility is needed to see clearly. Listen to what Jesus says. This has always been an astonishing verse to me. And I'm not saying that about you this morning. I'm not saying it about this church. But it's written to a church. It's written in the book of Revelations. And Jesus is speaking to these Christians, this church in Revelations chapter 3, verse 17. And this is what he says. He says, "You say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." It's like, wow, did those guys get it wrong or what? Like, they were completely had the wrong opinion of themselves. They lacked the humility to see their smallness in the scheme of things, and they valued their temporary success and were blind to the true picture of who they really were. That's astonishing, isn't it? I find that amazing. And so we can all at times suffer from a warped value system. And we can all at times fall into, valuing things wrongly, the Bible says that we can think more highly of ourselves than we should. We can look in the mirror, we can look at our life, we can look at our bank balance, we can look at our outward things, our clothes, our car, our position. We can look at some outward things and we can value ourselves or think more highly of ourselves than we should. And in the same breath, the Bible says we can think too lowly of ourselves. We can see ourselves as the big hero if we do good, or we can see ourselves as the big villain if we fail. And we often get it wrong, the wrong perspective. And we can value and we can judge ourselves using the wrong scale. And so God's design is that each of us would seek him and find our worth and value in him and get a correct perspective on who we really are. And so we're trying to see the value in humility. Popularity is probably more of a desired thing than humility today. Would you say that's right? Talking generally in our culture, in our society. Prosperity is probably a more desired thing than humility today. Happiness is probably a more desired trait than humility. But when we understand who Jesus is, his humility, it causes us to see its true value. Let's consider Jesus, Philippians 2, verse 5. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all names. Here's Jesus, and it was his humility that caused him to come as a man. It was his humility that caused him to come as a servant. It's his humility that caused him to go to the cross and die for the sins of the whole world. The most important thing that's ever been done on the planet was done through humility. Greatness through humility. God's exalted him to have the name that's above every other name. The greatest person to ever be on this planet was the humblest person to ever be on this planet. The disciples argued, Jesus' disciples argued about who was the greatest, and Jesus showed them. And humility was the key. So let's move on and look secondly at the fact that humility is a key part of God's wardrobe for you and me. It says that we're to clothe ourselves with humility. One place it says, one translation says, we've got to put on humility. And so it's God's will that we be clothed with humility. 1 Peter 5:5, yes. All of you be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. I read an article on the 15 most expensive clothing brands in the world, probably which all of them are here this morning. And if you've got expensive clothes, that's okay. So I'm not having to go at that. But this is what the article said. The right clothes have the power to sway decisions in your favour and mould circumstances as per your wishes. The global luxury apparel industry is valued at nearly $300 billion and is on a continuous rise as more and more individuals are leaning towards elite and luxurious items. The exclusive fashion labels and most expensive clothing brands are associated with power, prestige and status. And so amongst the most expensive clothing brands, apparently the first or most expensive clothing brand is Oscar de la Renta, with a net worth of an estimated $26 billion. Number two's Louis Vuitton, Gucci, Prada, Ralph Lauren, Armani. There's all these different other ones, etc., etc. And again, it says this, it's important to wear clothes that will enhance your looks and speak volumes about your personality and fashion sense. And so as I read this, I thought, I'm going to go and look in my wardrobe. And one of the t-shirts in my wardrobe, the brand name was Basics. And that wasn't on their list, the top 15, I'm not sure, maybe 16th, I'm not sure. Another t-shirt said extra large regular, that's all it said. And then I pulled out some shorts, and the brand of my shorts, apparently, it's on there, it says Ken. And I thought, with the new Barbie movie that's come out, I'm going to get these Kens out during summer, and I'm going to wear my Ken shorts and be fashionable, I guess. I don't know, do I have to wear them inside out, because the label's unfortunately on the inside. In our text, it says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And the therefore there, it says, therefore, as God's, it refers to the fact that we've been changed by Christ, that we have a new life in Christ, that the old life is gone and now we have a whole new life, and God calls us to live differently. And it speaks about sexual promiscuity and just doing whatever you want and displaying a bad temper and being mean and profane in how we speak, telling lies, etc., etc. And it goes on, it says this in the Message translation, it says you're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes you've stripped off and put in the fire. It talks about our old life. And it's not a great translation, but it's a great understanding of what the Bible tells us there. It says we have an old life, and it's just like you had a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes. You've stripped them off and put them in the fire, and God is giving us something far more fitting. God's given us a different picture of who, a different image of who we are. And so it's talking about an inward change. It's not talking about an outward picture of what we wear or don't wear. It's a change of heart. It's a change of mind. The Message translation says this in verse 10, now you are dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with His label on it. All the old fashions are now obsolete. All the old behaviors, all the old attitudes are obsolete. What we used to get dressed up in to go to school or go to work or interact with people, the protective mechanisms that we have in our life, the bravado and the pride that we have in our life, they're all obsolete. And he says, dress yourself up completely different. You need to be kind. You need to be humble. So God's designed a whole new way of life. It involves a change on who we are on the inside. In the Message, verse 10 says, now you're dressed in a new wardrobe and every item of your new life is custom made by God with His label on it. That's what God wants in our life. He wants to put His print, His fingerprint, His design upon our heart, upon our life. Verse 12 says, so chosen by God for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God has picked out for you. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, and discipline. The wardrobe that God has picked out for us. And see, the truth is, this morning, it's your choice. Just as it's your choice, you can go to your wardrobe, you can go to a shop, and you can choose what sort of outfit you want to wear, how you want to present yourself or represent yourself. It's your decision, and God's not going to come down this morning and grab you by the scruff of the neck. I'm not going to come down and get in your face and say, you need to be humble, you need to put on humility. It's your choice. Whether that's the way that you want to roll or some other way. When our kids were small, and I've used this illustration before, when our kids were small, we used to shop at Best and Less, Kmart and Target, because they were the top 15 brands in the world back then. They were the cheapest ones that we could afford. And so, but later, as they grew up a little bit, they wanted some surf brands, Quicksilver and Billabong, and because their friends had that, and they wanted to look, fit in and be fashionable and wear all that sort of stuff, and I understand that very much. But later they didn't want to wear those surf brands because those surf brands became the clothes that dads and granddads wear. And so they didn't want to wear that sort of stuff anymore, and so they wanted some new stuff, and it was it was disappointing to us because we just wanted them to wear the same clothes forever and just save us some money. but that's how it was, and they didn't want to wear the item that we hope would bless them, and an item that had cost us something. And in the same way, I believe that God is no doubt disappointed when we value the world's outward yardsticks of success or how to be, rather than the clothes that he wants us to put on the inside, the attitudes that he wants us to put on the inside, and the things that we should value but maybe we don't value. His fashion. Live in a world that's dog eat dog and survival of the fittest and aggressiveness in business and all sorts of, I'm not saying that we become a doormat or be pushed over in different areas of life, but I'm saying, is humility there in the mixture? Is humility, are we willing to, be humble before God? And so God's got a wardrobe picked out, and one of the things specifically that he picks out for us to put on day by day by day is humility. And so we've looked at the value of humility is good too. We've looked at how God wants us to be covered in humility. He wants us to, that needs to cover some of the other attitudes that we feel at times. We don't feel like we want to be humble. We don't feel like we want to be kind, but we need to choose that instead and put that on. In the same way, when we have a spirit, the Bible says, of heaviness and life's heavy, we're to put on a spirit, a garment of praise, and cover that and choose to speak life and choose to praise God. And those things are actually good for us. Those things make us most attractive and appealing in God's eyes. And I want to finish and look thirdly this morning at the benefits of humility. And number one, humility protects us from pride and brings God's favor. I remember seeing a bumper sticker that said, "Get real, get humble." I like that. That's a cool bumper sticker. And let me ask the question, what have we got to be so proud about anyway? The Bible says that we are dust, and to dust we will return. The Bible says we are a vapor that appears for a little while and then we're gone. And God's ways are far above our ways, and his thoughts are as far as the heaven is above the earth. So what have we got to be prideful about? I don't know about you, but that's God's picture there. As sciences begin to understand more and more about the universe we're part of, God's ways are as far above our ways, and his thoughts as far above our thoughts as the heavens are above the earth. Corinthians 3:18 and 19 says, the Message translation, it says, "Don't fool yourselves. Don't think that you can be wise merely by being up to date with the times." And it goes on in verse 19 and says, "What the world calls smart, God calls stupid." And you talk to some folks and there's this garment of pride, it's, have you ever spoken to someone, it's like, "When I get to heaven, I'm going to tell God." And it's like, well, listening to you, I don't know if you're going to get to heaven, brother. Number one, and I'm not entirely sure what you're going to tell God, because God already knows what you think, and in fact, he knows what you're going to think in 2 weeks' time. Yes. And he knows the beginning and the end of your life, and he sees that you're a vapor that appears for just a moment. But we can choose humility in the same way that we can choose clothes to wear each day, and I want to commend that to you. I want to recommend that to me and to you, that we put on humility. 1 Peter 5:5-9 says, "Be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your enemy," or your adversary, "the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith. And being clothed with humility is my safeguard. It's your safeguard against one, pride, and two, the devil. It really does, because the devil gains access and can direct us and begin to pull the strings like a puppet master, and people get so caught up in pride and self-deception that they fail to live the life that God in his love and grace wants us to live. So number one, it protects us from pride. Number two, humility protects us from being a fool. Have you ever seen someone that's intoxicated and they're acting like a fool? Maybe it was us. Not at your best. They're not at their best when they're intoxicated. Romans 12:3 says, "For I say to everyone not to think of himself more highly than he ought, but to think soberly." Soberly. Think soberly, as opposed to being intoxicated with yourself. You're intoxicated with what you've done and who you are, and you're thinking more highly about yourself than you should. And I remember a friend years ago, and he was intoxicated, and he was maybe 5'9", maybe 75 kilograms, and he decides he's going to teach the bouncer at this pub some respect. He knows that he's intoxicated and he's not thinking rightly. And the bouncer there, you know, he looks like some sort of Tongan football player. He's probably about 6'3" and 130 kgs. And it's like he's not thinking soberly. He's thinking of himself more highly than he ought. It's like, I can beat this guy. It's like, no, you can't, bro. We had to sort of get him and take him away from there for his own good. And he wanted to fight us because we weren't going to let him get injured and make a fool of himself. And so in the same way, think of the devil. He was a good-looking dude, the old devil. He's a good-looking fella. He was skilled. He was talented. He was awesome. But he got intoxicated with his own self-opinion and his own self-importance. So now he's going to pick a fight with God. Ezekiel 28:12. You are the model of perfection, full of wisdom and exquisite in beauty. That's Lucifer. That's the devil. Exquisite in beauty. Verse 14, I ordained and anointed you as the mighty angelic guardian. God had a plan, and an important plan and purpose for Lucifer. Verse 15, you were blameless in all you did from the day you were created until the day evil was found in you. Verse 17, your heart was filled with pride because of all your beauty. So the devil became intoxicated with his own self-importance, with his own beauty. God created him like that. But he thought it was something somehow that he'd done. He thought he was more important than he really was. And it's like, and he picked a fight with God. Isaiah 14, verse 12. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you were cut down to the ground, mighty though you were against the nations of the world. For you said to yourself, I will ascend to heaven and rule the angels. I will take the highest throne. This is the Living Bible. Verse 14, I'll climb to the highest heavens and be like the Most High, but instead you'll be brought down to the pit of hell, down to its lowest depths. Wow, talk about pride goes before a fall. The devil was awesome. He was awesome. God created him to be awesome, to be exquisite, to be gifted and talented and powerful and blameless, until pride got the better of him and he didn't put on humility. He didn't maintain humility. So God wants to save us from being a fool and thinking more highly than we should. He wants to help us to keep our rightful place and run in the lane that he's got for us, and have a humble and thankful heart that's willing to serve others like Christ. And he says, let this mind be in you. What mind? The humble mind. Let the humble heart be in you. Clothe yourself with this. And the third thing, the final thing I've got for you this morning is humility brings a teachableness and a teachability. And I'm not sure about you, but I've still got a lot of stuff to learn. I'm still learning. I need God to show me. I need the Holy Spirit to teach me. I need the Word of God to direct me. I need to take my cues and not think too highly or too lowly of myself. I need to think of myself as God thinks of me. That I'm greatly loved, but I got no opportunity or possibility of blowing my own trumpet here. He's the one that gets to blow the trumpets. I remember a returned pastor years and years ago, and he came back into the church, and he came back and he said, "I don't think there's much for me to learn here." Well, you could learn to be humble, bro. learn to be teachable. Romans 12:16, be of the same mind towards one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Don't look down on people. Don't think you're better than people. Be careful in this arena. It's a difficult thing. Because in some areas we might be better. We might be better at snooker than someone else. We might be better at mathematics than someone else. We might be better at running than someone. We might be better at something. We might know more scripture than someone. But we're all judging. We can judge on this comparison thing rather than judging with righteous judgment. And right judgment is why I think I'm probably wise not to be considering myself better than anyone, because they might be better at being humble. They might be better at being kind. They might be more generous. I don't know who they are. And sometimes I don't even know who I am. It's like, God, you show me. And that's why the Bible says we need the mirror of the Word of God. Who's ever looked into the mirror of the Word of God and go, whoa, thank God I looked in the mirror. I've got egg on my face. Yeah, thank God I looked in the mirror. It's like, I'm not who I thought I was. I'm only 5'9". Sorry if you're 5'9" this morning. There's nothing wrong with being 5'9". I'm 5'9½", actually. It's a little bit better than that. But. And so as we close this morning, Titus chapter 3, verse 1 to 5 says, remind them, that's you, that's me, remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men. For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy and hateful and hating one another. But when the kindness and the love of God our Saviour toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Let's bow our heads before God this morning. He saved us, not that we were worthy, not by our works of righteousness, not because we were the greatest of the disciples, not because we did anything, but because God did everything. He sent his son Jesus to come, and he came from heaven and came as a man and humbled himself. He came as a servant to serve fallen mankind. He came as a servant to lay down his life and suffer death on the cross for sinners. Sinners like you and sinners like me. I don't know about you, but that's tremendously humbling. Whenever I read those verses, it's like, whoa. Jesus says that we can easily get caught up and pray, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, like this man, he's an extortioner, and this man here, he's a tax collector, and not like this person here. And we can easily, so easily compare ourselves unwisely with other people and lack the humility that God's got for us to clothe our nakedness, to clothe our heart, that we can be filled with a wonderful, sweet spirit. The Spirit of Christ, humility. Thank God for his presence. Thank God that he does help us and humble us. He doesn't want us to walk around and think that, you know, like we're a dog and we're nobody. He loves us. We're adopted as his children. We're sons and daughters of the Most High God. Our names are written in heaven. But not because we earned that, not because we deserve that. We got mercy instead of wrath. Because God's good. And I don't know about you, but it can so help keep perspective. When we live in a world that this is the best, this will make you somebody or something. Wonderful God. The Bible says that the one who lives in eternity, the high and lofty one, he lives in the holy place with those whose spirits are contrite and humble. He says he restores the crushed spirit of the humble and revives the courage of those with repentant hearts. And this morning, I want to give you an opportunity to come and spend some time in prayer. And look, I don't know, and I'm not accusing anyone of pride or thinking more highly than they ought, but I can tell you that as I prepared this sermon, that I prayed some prayers of repentance and humility. And thank you, Lord, for showing me how valuable humility really is. It's a picture of your son, Jesus. Before we pray, before we open the altar for prayer, I want to give you an opportunity. You're here this morning, but you're not born again. The Bible says that we're born again when we believe in Jesus Christ, when we confess Jesus as the Son of God, as our Lord. The Bible says that he died on the cross 2,000 years ago for the forgiveness of our sin. He took mankind's sin, your sin, my sin upon himself, and shed his sinless blood, gave his life's blood for us, a sacrifice. He died a substitute in our place. And that if we'll believe in him in our heart and confess him as Lord, the Bible says we'll be born again from above. That's something that God does. That's not something that we do. It's not something that we do in the church. It's not something that some ritual does, but it's something that God does to sincere hearts that receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And this morning you're not a Christian, but you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You want to acknowledge before God, God, I am a sinner, I need a Savior. Heaven's perfect, I can't go unless my sins are taken. Jesus took your sins. And you can pray a prayer and receive Jesus into your life this morning as your Lord and Savior. Be born again from above. Powerful work of God in your life. I want to invite you to do that. If that's you and you haven't done that, you can raise your hand. That's me, Pastor. I want to be saved. I want to be born again. I want to be forgiven of all my sins. I want to make heaven my home when I die. And I'd like to pray. Anybody at all with an uplifted hand? That's me, Pastor. That's me. You can lift your hand. We'll pray with you this morning. Maybe this morning you're here and you prayed a prayer once upon a time and you've gone back on that, you've walked away, and Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart. He wants back in, he wants to come into your heart, and you want to recommit your life to Christ. You'd like to pray, you could lift your hand. Anybody at all, you're not a Christian, you haven't been saved, or maybe you're just away from him, you've turned your back on him, and you want to come back to him, and you'd like to pray a prayer. Anybody at all, like to pray a prayer this morning, you could lift your hand, have somebody pray with you. Praise God. Give you an opportunity to pray this morning. The altar's open. The value of humility, simple thought, simple message. It's something I believe is important to our God. Thank you, my God. Thank you, Jesus. Your example, your heart. Thank you, my God, for your love and for your goodness toward us. Thank you, Lord, that you laid down your life for other people. You weren't just interested in putting on an outward show. You're interested in other people. You're interested in the lostness of mankind. I thank you, my God, for your goodness. I thank you, my God, for your presence in this place, in this altar this morning. Lord, I thank you, God, that you're touching humble hearts this morning, my God. I thank you, God, the spirit of servanthood that's in this church, Lord. God, I thank you, Father, your wonderful presence. wonderful, God, touching hearts, Father, at this altar this morning, Lord. God, doing business on the inside, God, reminding us, encouraging us, Lord God, meeting with us, Father. Oh, Jesus, have your way, Lord God, in heaven and on earth.
Glorious, glorious. more of me, says the Lord. I will pour out my spirit upon you, and I will show you what it is to be more of me. Put yourself in my word and in my way. Align yourself with who I am, and I will show them who I am through your humility, says the Lord.
Wonderful God. Wonderful God. Praise you. Praise you.
Humility is forgiveness. The Lord asks that we must forgive those. We must forgive the harsh words spoken or the harsh words received. With my grace and my meekness, you will find humility, but forgiveness is the key, says the Lord.
Yes, my God, praise you.
Powerful words there, God speaking to us by the Holy Ghost. I really believe that this morning. And when you think of it, you know, that story, that parable, he's the guy that's forgiven gazillions of dollars, and that's us. We've forgiven everything because Jesus humbled himself, and then the guy went outside and he wouldn't humble himself to forgive a guy that owed him $2. And so I just want to encourage you just to run with that, you know, that let God be God, let yourself be small, let God fill you with his wonderful and sweet presence, and forgive people. And if there's anybody, anything, hurtful stuff, real stuff, genuine hurts and offenses that come, I encourage you in Christ, in the power of the Holy Ghost, forgive, release it, let them go. And now let God sort it, let God deal with it. But be humble. Wonderful God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give him praise one more time. Let's thank him for his goodness. Wonderful God. Appreciate you coming out today. We're going to close off in a word of prayer. I'm going to ask Stu if he would do that for us. Close us off. Thank you.
Father God, we do thank you, God, for this word this morning. God, seal it in our lives. God, I pray, God, you'll bless us as we go this morning and help us return safely tonight. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.